Hello everyone, welcome to Chemistry for All. Before entering into video, we are going to see random shout out. Okay, in this video we are going to see a comment of service. He told, thanks a lot bro, learned a lot. It is very happy to hear that some students is learning from my video. And if your comment or if your name want to be in random shout out, the only thing you need to do is make a valid comment. Now we will enter into today's video. Okay, now we are seeing NCERT class 11 unit 11. Okay, the P block elements, this is the lesson we are seeing right now, and we have already made two videos in this particular chapter. If you are new to this our channel or new to this video, you can go to our playlist and see that video. Okay, or you can see a link appearing here, you can use that link also. Now we will enter into today's lesson. Okay, so this is the thing. You can see a pink color box here. I am going to explain that box first. You can see a question here itself. I am not going to read question or anything. I am just going to explain the definition actually. Standard electrode potential value for two half cell reactants suggests that the aluminium has high tendency to make Al3 plus ion, whereas thallium 3 plus is not only unstable in solution but is powerful oxidizing agent also. So what actually they are trying to tell? If you take, for example, I am taking two substances, okay? One is aluminium 3 plus and another is thallium 3 plus, okay? Now I am putting them two in one solution, okay? Aluminium 3 plus remain as aluminium 3 plus, so there is no problem. But thallium 3 plus get reduced, or in other words, thallium 3 plus will get two electrons from someone else, and it will convert into thallium 3 plus to thallium plus oxidizing state, because thallium 3 plus state is unstable, kind of unstable state. Thallium plus 1 is stable, okay? We already seen that why thallium plus 1 is stable in our previous video. So thallium 3 plus will get electron from some other element. In other word, it is going to oxidize some other element, okay? So that's why thallium 3 plus we call it as an oxidizing agent itself, okay? So thallium plus is more stable in solution than thallium 3 plus. Aluminium being able to form plus 3 easily is more electropositive than thallium. So you are comparing thallium plus 1 and aluminium 3 plus. You can see aluminium has 3 plus while thallium has only plus 1, okay? So aluminium having more electropositive character when comparing to thallium. So that is what they are explaining in that pink color box, okay? Now we will go to next paragraph, that is reactivity towards air. Okay, while we are reading the topic that reactivity towards air, most people think like air is only made up of oxygen, okay? No, it is not a correct thing. Air is made up of various gases. It may have an oxygen, have a nitrogen, or even carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, even some poisonous gas also there may be present in minute amounts, okay? So air consists of every kind of gases. Boron is unreactive in crystalline form. You need to remember that, because we will see some boron reaction in later chapter. So remember this word, okay? Boron is unreactive in crystalline form. Aluminium forms a very thin oxide layer on the surface, which protects the metal from further attack. So what they are actually trying to tell from this first four lines is boron is unreactive. In other words, boron doesn't react with air, so boron remains as boron itself, okay? But aluminium react with oxygen in a minute amount. For example, if I am having a aluminium bar, okay, if this is considered as aluminium bar, this outer layer get oxidized and form a coating kind of thing, okay? This coating will prevent from further oxidation, because further oxygen can't get react because the coating act as a barrier, okay? So that's what they are trying to tell, okay? Amorphous boron and aluminium metal on heating in air form B2O3 and Al2O3. So we already told crystalline boron is different, amorphous boron is different, okay? And amorphous boron and aluminium are reacting with oxygen, and it is forming B2O3 and Al2O3. So these two they have given. And one more thing you need to notice, only boron and aluminium will give these kind of thing, because other thing they are not given, because there is some reasons. With dinitrogen at high temperature they form nitrides. So usually people think whenever the word come like this, like dinitrogen, people think like it is some new compound. No, dinitrogen is nothing but nitrogen molecule. I will write this. You can see N triple bond N, okay? This is nitrogen molecule, N2 molecule. So dinitrogen, because there is two nitrogen, that's why they are given a name as dinitrogen, okay? So be familiar with these kind of chemical terms. Dinitrogen high temperature, they form nitrates. Nitrates you already know, it is triple bond N, okay. So here E means element. This element may be boron or aluminium, okay. So element plus oxygen gives Al2O3 or B2O3, okay, because we have already seen. And second one is also going to be same. So they on heating, and delta means heating. This triangle kind of thing above arrow, that is called as delta, okay. In other words, I am heating that substance and it will give a nitrites. The nature of these oxide varies down the group. Boron trioxide is acidic and reacts with basic metallic oxide forming metal borates. So this thing you need to note, that if you doesn't studied unit 3, that is classification of element, go to our playlist and learn that lesson, because it is a very important lesson, okay. And with that lesson, if you study the lesson, this is going to be very very easy, okay, because you already know metallic oxides are basic in nature, non-metallic oxide are acidic in nature. You already know boron is a non-metal, okay. So if a boron is forming oxide, then it is going to be non-metal oxide, then it is an acidic in nature. That's why boron trioxide is acidic, and you already know acid react with the base, okay. That's why it is reacting with the basic metallic oxide forming metal borates, okay. Actually it is a salt kind of thing. Acid plus base will give a salt neutralization reaction. Aluminium and gallium oxidize are amphoteric, and those of iridium, okay. First then we will see aluminium and gallium, okay. Aluminium and gallium are metalloids. They are not metal and they are not non-metal, okay. They come in between those two, metal and non-metal. So they are called as amphoteric oxide, because in respect with the base they will react as an acid. With respect to acid they react as base, and vice versa. If I am putting aluminium oxide in a base, aluminium oxide will react as an acid. If I am putting aluminium oxide in a base, it is going to react like an acid, okay. So depend on situation, it will change its property. That's why it is known as amphoteric. And those of iridium and thallium, on moving from top to bottom, metallic character increases. I already told metallic oxide are basic in nature. So iridium oxide and thallium oxide are going to be basic in properties, okay. So you don't need to memorize this paragraph. If you know the concept, it is going to be very easy. Now we will go to next,
okay,
para. The next para we are going to see is going to be reactivity towards acid and alkalis. How this boron and aluminium are reacting with acids and alkalis, okay. Alkali means base. Boron does not react with acid and alkalis even at moderate temperature. So they are talking about crystalline boron, I guess, because we already saw crystalline borons are unreactive in nature, okay. But aluminium dissolve in mineral acid and aqueous alkalis and thus show amphoteric character. We already told aluminium is a metalloids, okay. It has a both a character of metal and non-metal, okay. And it also has an amphoteric property. That's why it is going to react with both acid and base. Aluminium dissolve in dilute HCl and liberate dihydrogen. So HCl is an acid, everyone knows HCl is a mineral acid, okay. So aluminium reacting with HCl and gives Al3 plus and 6Cl2 plus, and it is evolving hydrogen gas. However, concentrated nitric acid renders aluminium passive by forming two protective oxide layer. So people who are wondering like why nitrate acid or nitric acid doesn't react with aluminium, or how this aluminium retaining its structure, it is very simple. In our first paragraph we already saw aluminium forms a protective layer when reacting with oxygen, okay. That protective layer will protect it from further oxidation. The same way nitric acid is an oxidizing agent. In other words, the same thing going to repeat. Aluminium layer is going to get oxidized first, and that oxide layer is going to protect it from further oxidation, okay. That's what going to happen. Now we will go to next reaction, that is aluminium also react with aqueous alkali. Alkali metal, you already know alkali metal means lithium, sodium, potassium, those group comes under alkali, okay. So if I am dissolving that in some water, it is going to be aqueous alkali, like NaOH, lithium OH, it is going to form like that, okay. And when aluminium react with those alkali hydroxide, they will form H2 gas, okay. They will evolve H2 gas. That's what they are trying to tell. In other words, aluminium has an amphoteric property. It will react with both acid and base. That's what they are trying to tell in this paragraph. Now we will move to next one. Okay, the next para is reactivity towards halogens, okay. Right now you already know what are halogens. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Those are all called as halogen, okay, or halogen family. These elements react with halogen to form trihalide, okay. So they have given example of thallium iodide actually. thallium triiodide. Okay, so this E is going to be any boron family metal, for example boron, aluminium, gallium, inidium and thallium, and this X2 is going to be any halogen family. Okay, so it is forming a trihalide. But actually I have little doubt in this paragraph, because we already know thallium prefer plus 1 oxidation state over plus 3 oxidation state. Okay, so they have given an example of thallium plus 3, because it has a 3 iodine, each iodine have a charge of 1 minus. Okay, so totally 3 iodine means 3 minus, and thallium should have a 3 plus. Okay, now I am asking you a question. Thallium I3, that is thallium trihalide, is a stable compound or not? If you think it is an unstable compound, tell me in comment section, and also don't forget to give the reason. Okay, if your answer is correct, I will pin that comment. Okay, now we will go to next one. White fumes appear around the bottle of anhydrous aluminium chloride, give reason. Okay, so now they are asking a good question. Actually these kind of questions are very useful if you go to some chemistry lab, something. Okay, it shows you have more experience or more exposure towards chemistry. Anhydrous aluminium chloride is partially hydrolyzed. Anhydrous aluminium chloride, first of all understand what is that. Aluminium chloride, if aluminium chloride is purely removed from water, if aluminium chloride doesn't have any water content, then I can call that as anhydrous. Anhydrous means no water. Okay, and means opposite, hydrous means water. Okay, aluminium chloride is partially hydrolyzed with atmospheric moisture. You already know atmosphere, our air has water molecule in it. Okay, so it will get moistured because that aluminium chloride is completely out of water. So these air molecules in air will, sorry, water molecules in air will react with that aluminium chloride. Now this will give a kind of fume kind of thing to liberate HCl gas. Moist HCl appears white in color. Okay, so that is why that white appearance is coming, because water has H2O and this aluminium chloride has AlCl3. Chlorine from aluminium and H2 from water is going to react, and it is giving HCl, which appears as white in color. Okay, that's why it is forming the white color. Now we will go to next topic. Okay, now we are going into little bit important topic. Okay, important trends and anomalous properties of boron. I already told you what is the meaning of anomalous in one video. Anomalous means different. Okay, for example there is 10 student, 9 student behaving in one particular character, and one student having his unique kind of thing or different kind of property or different kind of character, then we will call them as the anomalous, something different. Okay, so boron is going to have that anomalous property. It is going to have some exceptional behavior also. Certain important trends can be observed in the chemical behavior of group 13 element. The trichloride, bromides and iodides of all these elements being covalent in nature are hydrolyzed in water. Okay, first they are telling about properties. Okay, for example every trihalides are for example BCl3, BF3, thallium Cl3, everything going to get hydrolyzed in water. In other words, I will try to draw this. For example, if I am taking BCl3, okay, I am putting it in water, then it will give H2O, it will give BOH trice. Okay, everything get hydrolyzed, that's what they are trying to tell. We will read the paragraph once again, you will understand. The trichlorides, bromides and iodides of all these elements being covalent in nature are hydrolyzed in water, so they can be hydrolyzed. Okay, first point ends. Species like tetrahedral MOH4- and octahedral MH2O6+3+ except in boron exist in aqueous medium, because you already know MOH4- exist in boron. Okay, but MH2O6+3+ can't exist in boron, because boron can only able to form maximum of 4 bond. Here there is going to have octahedral, there is going to have a 6 bond, so boron can't able to form 6 bond. That's why they are given a word except boron. Okay, exist in aqueous medium, so they both can exist in aqueous medium. Now we will see about boron little bit. The monomeric trihalide. Actually, what is actually monomeric? Monomeric means single or individual. Okay, being electron deficient or strong Lewis acid. So I hope many people know what is octahedral. Okay, element, if you take an element, the element should have totally 8 electron around it. Okay, if it doesn't have 8 electron, then we will call it as unstable, or kind of like whether it may be having excess electron or it have a deficient in electron. Okay, now I will give one example. If I am taking an example BF3, okay, BF3, okay, totally there are three bonds around boron, okay, each bond have an electron, total of two electrons, so totally there is three bonds, so totally there is how much number of electron around boron? 6, okay, what I told, I need 8 electron so that I can be stable, but boron is only having 6 electron, so I am calling it as electron deficient, okay. Okay, now this boron need 2 more electron to reach the number 8, okay. So this boron trifluoride will try to get the electron from some other atoms or some other molecule, okay. Now here it is going to be ammonia, NH3, because NH3 has a lone pair and it can donate that lone pair, okay. So this lone pair getting accepted by boron and it is forming a compound like BF3NH3, okay. So this is known as Lewis acid. Anything that accept an electron, okay, that we will call as Lewis acid. So the monomeric trihalide being electron deficient or strong Lewis acid, boron trifluoride easily react with Lewis bases. So which is going to be Lewis bases? Exactly, ammonia is going to be a Lewis bases because it is the one giving an electron, or electron donors are known as Lewis bases, okay, with Lewis bases such as NH3, that is ammonia, to complete octet around boron. If anyone know what is octet rule, or if you know any good easy example about octet rule, just comment it in comment section because it may help some other, okay. Now we will go to next one. It is due to the absence of d orbital that the maximum covalence of boron is 4. You already know boron is from second period, okay. Second period element doesn't have d orbital. So the maximum covalence or the maximum bond a boron can form is only 4, okay. Since the d orbital are available with aluminium and other elements, and when coming from aluminium, every element is going to have a d orbital, okay. So they have the ability to form bond more than 4 are available, okay. The maximum covalence can be expected beyond 4. So from aluminium, every element can have a bond more than 4, okay. Most of the other metal halide, example AlCl3, are dimerized though halogen bridging. So I will show the diagram, you will understand. So you can see here, this is known as dimerization, okay. So see, it is one AlCl3 and it is going to be another AlCl3, okay. Now we will see one more thing, that's why it is called as dimer, okay, dimer of AlCl3. Now this aluminium is surrounded by 4 bonds, okay. Each bond is made up of 2 electron, so this individual aluminium is surrounded by 8 electron. In other words, it is satisfying the octet rule, so this aluminium is stable. Same way for this aluminium, this is also going to have an 8 electron around it, so it is also going to be stable. Now you can see these two aluminium are bridged by or connected by a halogen, okay. That's why it is called as halogen bridged, okay. The metal species completes its octet by accepting electron from halogen in this halogen bridged molecule. So that aluminium is completing its octet by accepting an electron from an halogen atom, okay, and they are forming a bridge kind of bond with halogen. That's why it is called as halogen bridged molecules. I hope you understood from up to this. If you have any doubt or if you have any query, you can comment in comment section. You can also join in our Telegram group. Our link, Telegram link, is in our video description. So if you came up to this point of this video, congratulate yourself, because many people don't have patience to watch a chemistry video up to this long, okay. So consider yourself a gifted one. Now we are going to see our new subscriber, Manasvini Madala, and thank you for subscribing. And if your name want to be in this list, the only thing you need to do is press the red color button, and don't forget to press a bell icon near that so that you will get immediate notification whenever I upload a video, okay. Now we will enter into video, okay. Now we are going to see another important compounds of boron, okay. One is going to be borax and other is going to be orthoboric acid, I think. Oh yeah, orthoboric acid. We will going to see these two things. First one, borax. Okay, borax only. Borax. It is the most important compound of boron. So any textbook you take in chemistry, it is going to be a word you will see everywhere. It is going to be a very important compound. It is a white crystalline solid of formula Na2B4O7.10H2O, okay. So here it is an important point. If you are preparing for some exam like JEE or NEET, you should note these things, like its appearance. For example, it is white in color or crystalline in structure. and it has a formula of this one, okay? And it has a, the one thing you need to know, that is that .10H2O. What is that actually .10H2O? It is known as water of crystallization, okay? If you don't know about water of crystallization, just Google it. You will find some example and you will understand, okay? In fact, it contains the tetranuclear units, okay? So what is that word tetranuclear units? Something new actually. Okay, it is not a big thing. Right now you are seeing about boron, okay? So boron family is going to be a core important. And see this example, how many numbers of boron atom is there in this particular molecule? You will find that it has 4, okay? That's why it is given a name, tetranuclear unit. It has a nucleus. Nucleus means center, okay? Here boron is going to be in center, okay? And there is 4 nucleus or 4 boron going to be in center of that molecule. That's why it is known as tetranucleus molecule. And correct formula therefore is Na2B4O5OH bracket 4 times dot 8H2O. Borax dissolve in water to give an alkaline solution. So boron dissolve in water, they will give an alkaline solution. They have already told, you can see Na2B4O7 plus 7H2O gives 2NaOH plus 4H3BO3. Actually H3BO3 is kind of like acid, I guess. I don't know. If you know H3BO3 is acid or base, just comment it in comment section, okay? On heating, borax first loses water molecule and swells up, okay? So you already know borax has a water of crystallization, that is .10H2O or .8H2O, it having water, okay? So if I am heating that, first that water of crystallization will evaporate, okay? And after that water of crystallization, everything get evaporated, it will only have that Na2B4O7 something. Now it will get swelled up, or it will lose water and swelled up, okay? Then even after heating, if I am heating, even after that, it will decompose, okay? That is what going to happen. We will see that. On heating, borax first loses water molecule and swells up. On further heating, it turns into a transparent liquid. Transparent liquid means kind of like gel kind of thing, okay? Colorless gel, which solidifies into glass like material known as borax bed. The thing, one thing you need to note, that is that borax bed is actually comes with a different color with a different metal, okay? That will help in identification of boron element actually. You can see Na2B4O7.10H2O on heating, it is forming Na2B4O7. You can see that 10H2O is missing here because the 10H2O get evaporated or vaporized, okay? Now I am further heating that, now it is getting decomposed to NaBO2 and B2O3, that is boric anhydride. The one thing you need to know, that is boric anhydride is nothing but an anhydrous form of orthoboric acid only, okay? Then metaborate of many transition metal have characteristic colors, and therefore borax bed test can be used to identify them in the laboratory. I already told, these metaborate depend on the metal to which they are attached or reacted, they will give different kind of colors, okay? So depend on the metal, they are going to give a different kind of color. So I can use this as an experiment for finding out in laboratory. For example, when borax is heated in Bunsen burner flame with cobalt oxide, okay, COO, that is C small O and O. CO is a cobalt and that big O is going to be an oxygen, okay? On a loop of platinum wire, a blue colored cobalt BO2 twice bed is formed. That is borax bed, but a metal is going to be cobalt, okay? On reacting with the transition number, always remember that it is going to be transition element, not something like alkali or alkali earth metal, because transition metal has a unique property of giving different colors, okay? Now we completed borax, we are going to next topic, that is orthoboric acid. Now we will see next topic, that is orthoboric acid. Actually, to be honest, orthoboric topic, orthoboric concept is very less. Other than orthoboric, there is many small very important chemistry topics are there. We will see one by one, okay? Orthoboric acid, H3BO3, is a white crystalline solid with a soapy touch, okay? If you touch NaOH, actually if you touch the NaOH in your life, you will find that it is like a soapy thing kind, okay? So this orthoboric acid is also going to have a similar kind of thing only, okay? And it is white crystalline solid. It is sparingly soluble in water. Sparingly soluble means if you put orthoboric acid in water, it won't dissolve completely. Instead, it will only dissolve partially, okay? But in water, but highly soluble in hot water. So when you heat or increase the temperature of that liquid, it will completely dissolve, okay? It can be prepared by acidifying an aqueous solution of borax. Now they are telling just a preparation of how to prepare boric orthoboric acid. Na2B4O7 plus 2HCl plus H2O gives NaCl plus BOH3. Now I need to ask an interesting question. How many of you can able to draw a structure of H3BO3? Note once again. How many of you able to draw a structure of H3BO3 without seeing anything? H3BO3. So people may think like, bro, it is very tough. If we know this, why we want to see your YouTube channel? Now I am asking second question. How many of you able to draw a structure of B boron OH trice? Boron bracket OH trice, okay? How many of you able to draw? You will easily draw. You put boron in center and put OH around it and you will say B OH trice. Very simple. First molecule also same, right? H3BO3 and B OH trice are both are same. So this is the thing you need to note in chemistry. How you are studying chemistry, that only tells whether it is easy or tough, okay? So note that in point. It is also formed by a hydrolysis reaction with water. So they are giving one more example or one more preparation, okay? We are skipping that. It has a layer structure in which planar BO3 units are joined by hydrogen bond. Actually, hydrogen bond is a very interesting topic actually. I will make a hydrogen bond video separately. And the one thing you need to note that is, you can see here it is BO3. I will draw it. You can see it is a BO3, okay? Each BO3 attached with another BO3 with hydrogen bond. You can see there is one dotted line, okay? That is actually a hydrogen bond, okay? On heating, orthoboric acid above 370 Kelvin forms metaboric acid. So when heating, it is forming another thing, that is HBO2, which on further heating yields a boric oxide, B2O3. We have already seen boric oxide when we are in the first paragraph. Reaction with the air itself, we saw B2O3. H3BO3 on heating gives HBO2, that is metaboric, and further heating gives B2O3, that is boric oxide. And they have given the structure of that boric acid kind of thing, okay? Now that is the thing, hydrogen bond. If you are very much interested, search about hydrogen bond. It is a very important topic and very interesting topic also. Now I will tell you why boric acid considered as a weak acid. So they are telling boric acid is a weak acid. Why? Actually, boric acid has 3 hydrogen, okay? But it is called as monobasic acid, okay? If you know the answer, just comment it in comment section. Even though boric acid has 3 hydrogen, it is considered monoacid, not tribasic, okay? It is monobasic. If you know the answer, why? Comment it in comment section. Because it is not able to release H+ ion on its own, okay? That is true. Because if it releases H+ ion, there need to be some kind of stabilization process. So there is no stabilization process involved, so it can't leave H+ also. It receives OH- ion from water molecule to complete the octet. You already know boron surrounded by 3 OH means boron is surrounded by only 6 electrons, okay? So it needs 2 more electrons, so it will accept 2 electrons from OH- from water molecule. So it is a Lewis acid, okay? So that it is Lewis acid, but kind of like a weak acid only. It receives OH- ion from water molecule to complete its octet and in turn releases H+ ion. So that's why we are telling like boric acid is a weak acid. They have given this as an example. Okay, so we are ending this video here. If you have any suggestion or if you think this video needs some other improvement, just comment it in comment section. If you want to join our Telegram group, link is in our video description. And we have also started a quiz kind of thing in our Telegram group. So don't miss out. Stay safe.
No, give me that. You have the little one.